Hey people of the VC, it's Andy Cloudy Milder. Going to show my collection of rock and metal books. This is a response really to Vinylizer John. So he did a five-part series where he showed quite an extensive and impressive collection of books he's got relating to rock and metal. So I thought I would jump on that and show what I have. I've got quite a small collection. I didn't really get into reading non-fiction books until I was about 40. Suddenly my brain seemed to rewire. I could process them all of a sudden. Just could never concentrate on reading factual books before then. Check out John's channel. He's got a contest on at the moment because he wants to get to 1,000 subs and he wants your help. So if you've not subscribed to John Vinylizer's channel and you're subscribed to me, go and check him out. I think you'll find something you like. He shows all kinds of rock and metal, vinyl, CDs, all that sort of stuff, and books as well that he's done recently. He's a really nice chap. Go check him out. I'm going to start off with the only, I guess, non metal one really, and that's a biography by Mick Middles of the Manic Street Preachers. This is from 1999. As much as I love the Manic Street Preachers, I've not got around to reading this yet. I did start it years ago, but so it came out in 1999. I've probably had it for most of that time since then, but I've just never really felt the urge to dive into that one yet. This one, Iron Maiden On Board Flight 666. It's kind of like a picture diary. Covers 2008 to 2011 on the Iron Maiden tour. So lots of great pictures. Not much reading in it, so it's easy. But really cool book. On Board Flight 666. Now, this I Am Ozzy is the first, I guess, music biography, autobiography that I ever read. And that was about 3 or 4 years ago. And I read it in a week on holiday and I thoroughly enjoyed it. And since then, I've been picking up various autobiographies and biographies since then, learning a little bit more about some of the stars. Now, I do wonder, given the stories and the state that Ozzy was in at the time that these stories took place, I do wonder how he managed to remember so much in detail. But this is a thoroughly good read, cracking read. This is I Am Ozzy. What I'm reading at the moment, The Beast by Paul Di'Anno. Singing with Iron Maiden, the drugs, the greepies, the whole story. This is hard work. I'm about two-thirds of the way through, and I've probably had it on the go now for about 4 or 5 months. The reason it's hard going is 40% of it is stories about all the birds he shagged in quite graphic detail. 40% of it is about all the fights he's had in quite graphic detail, and 20% of it is really quite interesting. It could easily be half the size, just a chapter saying I shag loads of birds, a chapter saying I had loads of fights, and then concentrate on the stuff that's kind of more interesting. Some interesting bits in here, but I wouldn't recommend it. On the other end of the scale, I read Bruce Dickinson's before, and I found this one a bit bland. I don't know, just misses out anything potentially interesting from his life. Controversially interesting, should we say. He's kind of shied away. It's very much a matter-of-fact statement of pretty much who he is and what he's done. Just weird seeing whole albums, classic albums of Maiden kind of one or two pages loosely over because he maybe wasn't in the mindset. And the band was kind of just taking over at the time. Lots of stuff about aviation and flying. It's an interesting read. It's not kind of it's not the stuff that you want to, I want to hear in the autobiography. I mean, the stuff about the what allegedly happened between Nicky Six and his first wife. It's, none of that's in there. None of his family stuff's in there. And I'm not just so interested in hearing about his family, but, you know, I want to hear a little bit about the dirt, don't you? Speaking of dirt and Nicky Six, that's good. I haven't got the... this is the Heroin Diaries by Nicky Six. It's an interesting read. He spends a lot of time in his closet, scared of people coming to get him, all the paranoia associated with drug tests. I keep showing you that. Nothing on there. I don't have the dust cover. I picked this up really cheaply. But, yeah, still, it was an interesting read. It was good. This was good. Dave Mustaine's Hello Me, Meet the Real Me, A Life in Metal. Thoroughly enjoyed that one. I've also read David Ellefson's one. I sent that to John, so he showed that in one of his videos as well. The Ellefson one, I'd say, is, I don't know, it's just kind of, again, it's a little bit bland. Dave Mustaine kind of pulls no punches, whereas I think Ellefson has kind of made peace with everybody and he's not going to write a bad word about anybody. So there we go. The next up for me, when I finally get around to finishing The Beast, I'm going to take a look at For the Sake of Heaviness, the Metal Blade Records history. Not at all into this one yet, but I think Metal Mickey's read this one, says it's a good read, so looking forward to that one next. This is a strange one. I only bought this one last week, and I don't know whether this is going to be an easy read, a terrible read, but it kind of looked fun. And if fun for you is quantum physics, then maybe you want to read the Uncertainty Principle Goes to 11, or How to Explain Quantum Physics with Heavy Metal. It's written by a lecturer in quantum physics who's also a big heavy metal fan, so there's lots of things explained in the science behind heavy metal. I don't know. I might only get through one chapter of it. It might be a thoroughly good read, so if anyone's interested, I'll update you on that one in the future. Great read. Anvil, The Story of Anvil. If you've seen the movie, I recommend you read the book and then go and watch the movie again, because I think you get a lot more out of the movie. This fills in a lot of the blanks that they can't fit into the whatever 90 minutes of the movie. So, great read. Another great read, Heavy Metal in Baghdad. Story of a band called Across the Cowder, and how they got together and how they basically, with their love of metal, managed to escape the country through the conflict, and their take on the whole Iraq war. There is a documentary that goes with this that I would recommend watching. It's on YouTube, but the book is great as well. It's written as a series of interviews with members of the band and friends and other documentaries. Makers. Really good read. Thoroughly recommend that. Heavy Metal in Baghdad. Actually, this one isn't metal. This is Last Shop Standing. It's written by a guy called Graham Jones, who he used to distribute CDs. He'd travel around the country and go to all the independent record shops, and it's stories about the relationships he built up with the various owners. And this was written before the vinyl resurgence, when independent record shops were really, really struggling and they were closing down left, right and centre. So it's his kind of memoirs of visiting some of these stores and talking about the ones that are still standing and still going on. There is a second edition of this, which I'm interested in getting, just to see if it covers the vinyl resurgence and how shops are going back from going from vinyl to CD to back to vinyl again. So that's a thoroughly good one. It's all UK record shops, what have you. So if you live in the UK, you would probably recognise one of your local shops called out in this book. Moving into more reference, should we say. Well, this was not so much reference, but this is the The Sound of the Beast, a complete headbanging history of heavy metal. This was quite a good read, a little bit heavy, a little bit dry, but covers everything from sort of the 70s through to the 80s, and I have to admit, I got a bit disinterested by the time it got through to 90s and started talking about new metal. So this is one I've yet to finish, but I'll dip back into it one day and make myself finish that one off. Reference guide. So I've got the rough guide to heavy metal. This just has brief A to Z biography and highlights in the discography of various bands. I picked that up really cheap, only about a couple of pounds or so from a charity shop. Now we get onto the heavy hitters of reference books. This is the New Wave of British Heavy Metal Encyclopedia. It's a monster. This has every New Wave of British Heavy Metal band that you have never ever heard of, and a write-up of them, and what they went on to release, and or who was in the band is just phenomenal. It's obviously not one that you could necessarily read from start to finish, but love dipping into this occasionally, and by Malk McMillan. And John showed a couple of books from the Rock Detector series. He did show the A to Z of 80s rock. In fact, it was through John showing his copy. I had to go out and look up and pick it up, because I love reference books. It's really a bit sad, but I could just sit and browse through them for ages. This again has a small bio of each band and a full discography from the time. The book was published, or published after the 80s, so everything that was released in the 80s for that band. That's really good. To complement that, I also picked up the Rock Detector A to Z of thrash metal. Again, very similar thing, but with just thrash metal bands. And this one also came with a CD with a lot of bands I hadn't really heard of, to be honest with you. There we go. And the third one is the A to Z of power metal. Now, power metal, as far as this book's concerned, they cover bands like, you know, Judas Priest is in here, and Iron Maiden's in here significantly. So it's the classic kind of metal, you know, more straight up heavy metal, really. Stuff that maybe wouldn't be in just the plain 80s rock, and not fast enough to be in the 80s thrash. Although there is a certain amount of overlap between the 80s of power metal, thrash, and 80s rock, but I've got most of my bases covered here. There's also a black and a death metal version of that book as well, which I'm not interested in picking up whatsoever. Okay, moving away from metal, I've got some punk related books, which I'll show. First one up is this Hey Ho, Let's Go by the Ramones. I've tried dipping into this a few times. In fact, well, that's as far as I've gone the last time, and that was a few years ago. It's very dry. It's almost like reading a textbook rather than a history of one of the most interesting bands that's ever formed and played punk and rock music on the planet. But there we go again. And one day I hope to work my way through this, but just found it quite hard going. I always find something better to read. And I've got a couple of D.D. Ramone books as well. I think I got this one from Greg the Egg, although I've not read this one yet, Greg, because not long ago, before you sent it, that I sent, I read Poison Heart, Surviving the Ramones. And I'll wait quite some time before I dig into this one. Because it's obviously going to be pretty similar. But I can thoroughly recommend Surviving the Ramones, Poison Heart, and that one, I'll get around to it one day. And the last two are histories of punk. I picked this one up probably about 15, 16 years ago now. And again, it's It's very, very difficult to read. Not only is the text really small, which isn't really a problem, it's just I just find it a very difficult book to read. Again, it's very much written like a textbook, school textbook, rather than something that's flows and is interesting to read. Full of facts and good information, but I need to spend some time and figure out if I'm actually going to read this or not. I'll just get rid. And the last one is one that I have read. It's called Please Kill Me, The Uncensored Oral History of Punk. This one was a lot easier to read, actually. The whole book is, each paragraph is kind of interview. It's quoting. So it's Patti Smith here, Richard Hell, Debbie Harry, all kind of snippets on certain topics. Some Ramones chapter there with Danny Fields, Dee Dee Ramone, Mickey Lee, Arturo Vega. So it's kind of a little bit more interesting. It's written from the mouth of the artists. So that's my short but sweet book collection. There are other books like Lemmy's White Line Fever, which is brilliant, but what I tend to do with books is once I've read them, I don't tend to keep them around. I'll drop them off at the charity shop and then look for something else to fill the space. I'm not a hoarder of books. I just don't have the room. I need it for records. Okay, thanks for watching. Again, let's help John Vinylizer get to 1,000 subs. Check out his channel. I'll leave a link below. As I say, if you've not come across John before, I think you'll find something you like. He posts daily and all kinds of topics and band discographies and discussions and threads and all sorts. Good luck getting to 1,000, John. Hope you do it soon. Cheers. Thanks for watching.